Hello guys, this is YouTube channel Path and Lighter, and this video is regarding salient features of the constitution. This is second in the political series. This is important for all the exams you are going to give for political portion. And this is presented by me, Deepak Jaiswal. Now come about me. I'm an inspector since 2006, ranked 161 in APFC, joined as APFC Ahmedabad, from which I later resigned. Now Indian constitution, as we all know, is borrowed from many sources. And after borrowing it, it is tailored according to the Indian constitution, Indian conditions present at that time. So in this way, our constitution is unique in its contents and spirit. Now the number of original features of the constitution as adopted in 1949 have undergone a substantial change, because our constitution has made provision under Article 368 for amendments. So after under that article, there are many amendments which have been made in our constitution from time to time. Some important amendments which we have to remember is 7th amendment, 42nd amendment. This is also known as mini constitution of India, because almost every important part has been changed. And by this 44th amendment, all the things made, most of the things, not all, but most of the things changed under 42nd amendment act was reversed under this 44th Amendment Act. Then this is 73rd Amendment Act for Panchayati Raj, 74th Amendment for urban local bodies. Now, as I have already told, 42nd Amendment Act 1976 is known as mini constitution. There is a case in Supreme Court, Keso Nanda Bharti case, remember it, it is important. In this, Supreme Court ruled that the constituent power of parliament, that is making provisions of constitution, that is power of parliament under Article 368, does not enable it to alter the basic structure of the constitution. Basic structure is still not defined. So the Supreme Court in this case ruled that parliament cannot alter the basic structure of the constitution. Now the salient features of our constitution is, the first is our constitution is lengthiest written constitution. Reason being, all the provisions, all the things are mentioned in detail. Even state government, central government, CAG, main institutions, all the working, their provisions are described in this. So our constitution is lengthiest written constitution. In 1949, when the constitution was enacted, the constitution contained a preamble, 395 articles, which were divided into 22 parts and 8 schedules. Now it consists of a preamble, about 465 articles, which is divided into 25 parts and 12 schedules. Our constitution, as I have already discussed, that it is drawn from various sources. Structural part of the constitution is to a large extent derived from the Government of India Act of 1935. This almost 50 to 60% of our constitution is taken from this Government of India Act of 1935. So fundamental rights in our constitution are derived from the American constitutions. DPSP, which is Directive Principles of State Policy, is derived from the Irish constitutions. Political part of the constitution is derived from British, as we have experience of that. The principle of cabinet government and the relation between the executive and the legislature have been largely drawn from the British constitution. Now coming to blend of rigidity and flexibility. Let me first discuss about rigidity. What is rigidity and flexibility of the constitution? Regarding rigidity, rigidity is when we can't amend our constitution easily, then it becomes rigidity. And when it becomes flexible, it becomes flexible when we can amend it easily. So our constitution is a blend of rigidity and flexibility, just like our economy, which is not capital, not social, it is mixed economy. Similar way, we have taken rigid things from some part of the world and flexible things from part and incorporated it according to our need. So our constitution is basically a blend of rigidity and flexibility. Now come to the note. A rigid constitution is one that requires a special procedure for its amendment. As for example, the American constitution. While on the other hand, a flexible constitution is one that can be amended in the same manner as the ordinary laws are made. And this is for example, British constitution. We also know British has unwritten constitution. The laws made are actually the constitution there. The constitution of India is neither rigid nor flexible, but a synthesis of both. Article 368 itself provides two types of amendment. First, some provisions can be amended by a special majority of the parliament, that is, a two-third majority of the members of his house present and voting, and a majority of the total membership of his house, that is, more than 50% must be present. Now, second is, some other provisions can be amended by a special majority of the parliament and with the ratification by half of the total states. So, for some, we have to have two-third of the majority, and for some, we have to have 50% two-third and plus half of the states. Half of the states should ratify this to amended constitution. At the same time, some provisions of the constitution can be amended by a simple majority of the parliament in the manner of ordinary legislative process. Notably, these amendments do not come under Article 368. Now, coming to federal system with unitary powers, like economy, like rigid flexibility, our constitution is quasi-federal. Neither is it purely federal, neither it is totally unitary. So, Constitution of India establishes a federal system of government. It contains all the usual features of a federation, that is, two government, division of powers, written constitution, supremacy of constitution, rigidity of constitution, independent judiciary, and bicameralism. So, all these are features of a federation. When the state is a federation, that is, for example, United States. Indian constitution contains a large number of unitary or non-federal features. With that, as we have seen, these are federal features. Then what are non-federal features or unitary features? That is, a strong center, single constitution, single citizenship, flexibility of constitution, integrated judiciary, appointment of a state governor by the center, All India Services, emergency provinces, and so on. Moreover, the term federation has nowhere been used in the constitution. Article 1, other hand, describes India as a union of states. This is important, which implies two things. One, Indian federation is not the result of an agreement by the states. Like in the US, it is agreement by the states. And two, no state has the right to secede from the federation. Hence, the Indian constitution has been variously described as federal in form, but unitary in spread, that is, quasi-federal or bargaining federalism, cooperative federalism, etc. So, our is a blend of federal structure and unitary structure. Now, coming to parliamentary form of government, the Constitution of India has opted for the British parliament system of government rather than American presidential system of government. Why? Because we have experience of that. The parliamentary system is based on the principle of cooperation and coordination between the legislative and executive organs, while the presidential system is based on the doctrine of separation of powers between the two organs. Parliamentary system is also known as the Westminster model of government, responsible government, and cabinet government. The constitution establishes the parliamentary system not only at the center but also in the states. The features of parliament government in India are presence of nominal and real executives, majority party rule, collective responsibility of the executive to the legislature, membership of the ministers in the legislature, leadership of the prime minister or the chief minister, dissolution of the lower house. Even though the Indian parliamentary system is largely based on the British pattern, there are some fundamental differences between the two. For example, the Indian parliament is not a sovereign body like the British parliament. Further, the Indian state has an elected head, while the British has hereditary head. In the parliamentary system, whether in India or Britain, the role of the PM has become so significant and crucial that the political scientists like to call it prime ministerial government. Synthesis of parliament sovereignty and judicial supremacy. The doctrine of sovereignty of parliament is associated with the British parliament, while the principle of judicial supremacy with that of the American Supreme Court. This means that parliamentary sovereignty is taken from British and judicial supremacy is taken from US. Therefore, the scope of judicial review power of the Supreme Court in India is narrower than that of what exists in US. Because in American, the Constitution provides a due process of law against that of procedure established by law. This is the basic difference. That is, in American constitution it's written due process of law, while our constitution is a procedure established by law contained in the Indian constitution under Article 21. Therefore, the framers of Indian constitution have preferred a proper synthesis between the British principle of parliamentary sovereignty and the American principle of judicial supremacy. Supreme Court can declare the parliamentary law as unconstitutional through its power of judicial review. The parliament, on the other hand, can amend the major portion of the constitution through its constituent power. So, as we have seen, that there is parliamentary sovereignty as well as judicial supremacy. If judicial thinks that some law is unconstitutional, it can declare it null and void. And if parliament thinks that they are right, then they can amend the constitution through their majority in the Lok Sabha and Raj Sabha. Now coming to integrated and independent judiciary system. The Indian constitution establishes a judicial system that is integrated as well as independent. How it is integrated? Supreme Court, High Court and lower district courts. And how they are independent? Each of them are into Supreme Court, is Supreme Court at the center. Their cases are fixed, that these types of cases are discussed by them, the High Court and district court. The Supreme Court stands at the top of the integrated judicial system in the country. Below it, there are high courts. Under high court, there is a hierarchy of subordinate courts, that is district courts and other lower courts. This single system of court enforces both the central laws as well as state laws. While in US, the federal laws are enforced by the federal judiciary and the state laws are enforced by the state judiciary. The Supreme Court is a federal court, the highest court of appeal. This you remember because sometimes it's asked. The Supreme Court is a federal court. It is the highest court of appeal. It is the guarantor of the fundamental rights of the citizens and the guardian of the constitution. Hence, the constitution has made various provisions to ensure its independence, like the security of tenure of the judges, fixed service conditions, all the expenses of the Supreme Court charged on the Consolidated Fund of India, prohibition on discussion on the conduct of judges in the legislature, ban on practice after retirement, power to punish, and suppression of the judiciary from the executive, and so on. Now coming to third part, that is fundamental rights of the Indian constitution guarantees six fundamental rights to all citizens. The first is right to equality, which comes under Article 14 to 18. Then right to freedom, which comes under Articles 19 to 22. Then rights against exploitation, that is Articles 23-24, right to freedom of religion, 25-28, cultural and educational rights, 29-30, right to constitutional remedies, 32. So even if you can't remember each and every article, even then you must know that from which article to which article is related to what thing. This will help you in solving MCQs. And if you remember it, then there is no problem. The fundamental rights are meant for promoting the idea of political democracy. They operate as limitations on the tyranny of the executive and arbitrary laws of the legislature. They are justiciable in nature, that is, they are enforceable by the courts for their violation. The aggrieved person can directly go to Supreme Court under the various writs. The name of that writs are habeas corpus, mandamus, prohibition, certiorari and quo warranto, for the restoration of his rights. These we will discuss it later. However, the fundamental rights are not absolute. They are subject to reasonable restrictions. Further, they are not sacrosanct and can be curtailed or repealed by the parliament through a constitutional amendment act. They can also be suspended during the operation of a national emergency, except the rights guaranteed by Article 20 and Article 21. That means that under no condition these rights can be suspended. Now coming to DPSP, that is Directive Principles of State Policy. It is basically a guideline for the government. Then this is according to Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, the DPSP is a novel feature of the Indian constitution. They are enumerated in part 4 of the constitution. They can be classified into three broad categories. The first is socialistic, second is Gandhian, and third is liberal intellectual. The directive principles are meant for promoting the ideal of social and economic democracy. This is important, that they are meant for promoting the ideal of social and economic democracy. They seek to establish a welfare state in India. However, unlike the fundamental right, the DPSP are not justiciable in nature, that is, they are not enforceable by the courts for their violation. Yet the constitution itself declared that these principles are fundamental in the governance of the country, and it shall be the duty of the state to apply these principles in making laws. Hence, they impose a moral obligation on the state, moral obligation on the state authorities for their application. But the real force behind them is political, that is, public opinion. In the Minerva Mills case, this is also an important case, 1980, the Supreme Court held that the Indian constitution is founded on the bedrock of the balance between the fundamental rights and directive principles. These are some of the quotations which Supreme Court has used in the judgment. Now coming to fundamental duty, it is not in the original constitution but is added under Article 51A. On the basis of recommendation of Swaran Singh Committee by 86 constitutional amendment. So, fundamental duties, the original constitution did not provide for the fundamental duties of the citizens. These were added during the operation of internal emergency by the 42nd Constitutional Amendment Act of 1976 on the recommendation of the Swaran Singh Committee. The 86 added one more fundamental duty, the part 4A of the constitution, which consists of only one Article 51A specifies the 11 fundamental duties, vis-a-vis to respect the constitution, national flag and national anthem, to protect the sovereignty, unity and integrity of the country, to promote the spirit of common brotherhood amongst all the people, to preserve the rich heritage of our composite culture and so on. The fundamental duties serve as a reminder to citizens that while enjoying their rights, they have also to required consists of duties they owe to their country, their society and to their fellow citizens. However, like the DPSP, the duties are also non-justiciable in nature. Now coming to a secular state, questions can be asked. Secularism is a very hot topic. So Constitution of India stands for a secular state. This means that it does not uphold any particular religion as the official religion of the Indian state. Like Pakistan is an Islamic state, India does not uphold any particular religion, that India is a Hindu state or a Muslim state. So the term secular was also not mentioned in the original constitution. It was added to the preamble by 42nd Constitutional Amendment Act 1976. Now you are seeing that why 42nd Constitutional Amendment is known as mini constitution. However, there are two definitions of this secularism. There is Western concept and then there is Indian concept. First, we'll learn about what is Western concept. Western concept of secularism connotes a complete separation between the religion and the state. This means there must be a complete separation between the religion and the state. This is called negative concept of secularism, is inapplicable in Indian situation where the society is multi-religious. So, hence the Indian constitution embodies the positive concept of secularism, that is, giving equal respects to all religions or protecting all religions equally. Moreover, the constitution has also abolished the old system of communal representation, that is, reservation of seats in the legislatures on the basis of religion. However, it provides for the temporary reservation of seats for the SCs and STs to ensure adequate representation to them. Hence, the Western concept is complete separation between religion and the state. However, Indian constitution is giving equal respect to all religions or protecting all religions equally. Now coming to universal adult franchise. The Indian constitution adopts universal adult franchise as a basis of elections to the Lok Sabha and the state legislative assemblies. Every citizen who is over 18 years of age has a right to vote. This age was 21 years in original constitution. In 1989, by 61st Constitutional Amendment Act of 1988, this age was reduced to 18 years. The introduction of this was a bold experiment and highly remarkable in view of the vast size of the country, huge population, high poverty and all that. This enhances the self-respect and prestige of the common people, upholds the principle of equality, enables minorities to protect their interests and opens up new hopes and vistas for weaker sections. Because prior to independence, every citizen has not right to vote. There are certain sections, property holders or taxpayers who are able to vote in the elections. But after getting Independence, this universal adult franchise is introduced in the constitution so that each and every person who is ever been over and above 21 years of age can vote in the elections and elect their government or representatives. Now, concept of single citizenship is federal and envisages a dual polity. It provides for only a single citizenship. However, in USA, there is a dual citizenship, one of USA and second of that state in which they are residing. That is the Indian citizenship. Like in countries like USA, each person is not only citizen of USA, but also citizen of the particular state to which he belongs. The siege owes allegiance to both and enjoys dual sets of rights, one conferred by the national government, another by the state government. In India, all citizens, irrespective of the state in which they are born or reside, enjoy the same political and civil rights of citizenship all over the country, and no discrimination is made between them, excepting in few cases like tribal area, J&K, and so on. Despite the constitutional provision for a single citizenship and uniform rights for all the people, India has been witnessing the communal riots, class conflicts, caste wars, linguistic clashes, and ethnic disputes. This means that the cherished goal of the constitution makers to build a united and integrated Indian nation has not been fully realized. Now, coming to independent bodies, the Indian constitution not only provides for the legislative, executive and judicial organs of the government, but also establishes certain independent bodies like CAG office, UPSC, State Public Service Commission, Vice President of India, etc. They are envisaged by the constitution as the bulwarks of the democratic system of government of India. These are Election Commission, their function is to ensure free and fair elections to the parliament, state legislatures, the office of President of India, and the office of Vice President of India. So remember this, the parliamentary elections, state legislature elections, presidential election, and vice president election is conducted by Election Commission. Second is CAG. Its function is to audit the accounts of the central and the state governments. They act as guardian of public purse and comments on the legality and propriety of government expenditure. Third is UPSC, to conduct examinations for recruitment to All India Services, 15 and higher central service and 15 and higher central services, and to advise the president on disciplinary matters. The State Public Service Commission, in every state, to conduct examinations for recruitment to state services and to advise the governor on disciplinary matters. Thus, the constitution ensures the independence of these bodies through various provisions like security of tenure, fixed service conditions, expenses being charged on the CFI, that is Consolidated Fund of India. Now, coming to emergency provisions, the Indian constitution contains elaborate emergency provisions to enable the president to meet any extraordinary situation effectively. There are three main articles which you remember. That is, first is Article 352, it's national emergency on the ground of war or external aggression or armed rebellion. These three things: war or external aggression or armed rebellion. The second is Article 356, that is state emergency. President's rule, which is commonly called president rules, on the ground of failure of constitutional machinery in the states or failure to comply with the directions of the center, Article 365. So, state emergency or president rule in the state can be put up on the basis of these two things. That is, first is ground of failure of constitutional machinery in the states, or second, to comply with the directions of the center. Third is financial emergency, that is on ground of threat to the financial stability or credit of India. The basis or the motive behind these provisions is to safeguard the sovereignty, unity, integrity and security of the country. During an emergency, the central government becomes all-powerful and the states go into the total control of the center. It converts the federal structure into a unitary one without a formal amendment of the constitution. This kind of transformation of the political system from federal to unitary is a unique feature of our constitution. Now, coming to three-tier government. Originally, the Indian constitution, like any federal constitution, provided for a dual polity. Dual polity means central government, state government. Now, after 73rd and 74th Amendment, it has become three-tier government. That is central government, state government, and panchayat or urban bodies. See, it contains provisions regarding later the 73rd and 74th Constitutional Amendment Act 1992 have added a third tier of government, that is local government, which is not found in any other constitution of the world. The 73rd Amendment to Act of 1992 gave constitutional recognition to the panchayats, that is rural local governments, by adding a new part 917, I think this is wrong, and a new schedule 11 to the constitution. This is right, this I think added a new schedule 11 to the constitution. Similarly, 74 added schedule 12 with 74th constitutional amendment, that is for municipality, that is urban local bodies. Now coming to, so this is all it. Subscribe to this channel for free education. Promote it among friends. For any queries or suggestions, mail us at pathandlighter@gmail.com. I know this is a bit lengthy, but knowing this about our constitution almost covers 20% of the polity portion. So we have a brief idea, or we can say that we have summarized the constitution in these slides. Thank you.